So I'm working as a senior postdoc with Lucia Banci at CERM in Florence, and we've been working to develop a bioreactor system for monitoring intercellular events in real time by NMR. So this work was done within the work package 7. We are in CERN-CINP is involved in several work packages, and for development also in WP4. But in WP7, we have this data I'm going to show you was done within WP7. So it's part of the development of standardized workflows for structural biology directly in cells. And in fact, we focus on the development of a bioreactor system for in-cell NMR. In-cell NMR is a unique application of biomolecular NMR spectroscopy, which aims at obtaining structural and functional information of macromolecules directly in the environment of living cells. So it's an extremely powerful tool to obtain biologically relevant information, and also as to compare the data that one can contribute in vitro and determine what is the physiologically relevant conformation or function. There are several ways to perform in-cell NMR. It has been applied to different types of cells and organisms. Focusing particularly in human cells, we have developed a few years ago at CERM an expression protocol in which we can directly induce by transient transfection the overexpression of a protein inside the HEK293 cells, so which are human cells derived cell line. There are several other methods which one can use to deliver proteins instead of expressing them in the cells. These proteins can be recombinantly expressed and then delivered by fusion with peptides or by using pore-forming toxin or by electroporating the cells. In any case, these different approaches then allow you to obtain NMR spectra where you can selectively observe perturbation onto the structure and therefore obtain of proteins, and therefore obtain information on the function and on chemical events like folding and maturation events and many others. One of the biggest limitations of in-cell NMR is that at physiological temperatures, the cells are going to die very soon in the NMR tube, which is the sample holder. So we actually put a very high density of cells, around 30 million cells, in a very small pellet inside the NMR spectrometer, which means that at 37 degrees, they will last for a very short period of time. And then we start to go into a hypoxia and then to starve and accumulate toxic byproducts and acidify the medium. So we need them to improve the lifetime of the sample. We need a system to provide fresh nutrients and remove toxic byproducts. This can be done by flowing, using a flow unit to flow this fresh nutrient, which is basically the concept of the NMR bioreactor. This has two huge advantages. You can acquire for longer, which means being more sensitive and do higher dimensionality and more complex experiments. Or, as I will show you, you can observe events happening in real time by NMR. So to this aim, we took as example previous designs of NMR bioreactor, which have been developed by other groups in the world, based on custom-made designs and construction. And we have developed, in collaboration with Matteo Pennesti of Bruker UK, a system based on the Bruker Insight MR, which is a commercially available flow unit, with some adaptation. We developed two variants of bioreactor system. The first one is ideally applied to cells which naturally stay in suspension, so they can survive for long periods of time in suspensions, whereas the second one applies better to cells which do not stay into suspension, but they need to grow attached to some surface. In the first approach, the flow of fresh medium occurs within a coaxial microdialysis membrane, and by passive diffusion, the nutrients can reach the outer chamber where the cells will be put in suspension, as you can see in the picture. In the second design, which is actually simpler conceptually, the flow is applied directly at the bottom of the tube, which contains the cells, and the cells are entrapped inside the tube by encapsulation into hydrogels. We use the agarose in our case. So by diffusion through agarose, we can have a fresh media component of the fresh medium reach the cells and removal of toxic products. With the last second design, we reached excellent cell viability, which we measured by trypan blue staining for up to 3 days of experimental time, which is a lot compared to the maximum 2 or 3 hours that we allow ourselves to keep the cells into an NMR, above which we start to get massive cell death without any flow. And this can be seen very clearly here. So after 3 days, we get more than 90% viable cells in presence of the flow, whereas in a control experiment without any flow of medium, we see a very big effect in cell death. That can be monitored directly in the cell sample with a phosphorus 31 probe, with a broadband probe, for example, that can measure phosphorus, because we can then measure the beta ATP signal, which is unambiguously assigned to ATP. So it gives you a good picture of the metabolism, of the metabolic activity of the cells. And by measuring the ATP levels, we can see that that is roughly stable for 3 days, whereas shutting off the flow, that's the pink one, would cause an immediate drop in the ATP levels. So going towards the applications, we applied this system to perform drug screening in human cells, which is something that we showed that was possible to do with our approach in mammalian cells, in HEK cells, without the use of a bioreactor. For this, we chose as a model system, which is also pharmacologically relevant, human carbonic anhydrase 2, for which there are many active compounds and several approved drugs. This protein behaves well in the cytosol. Once overexpressed in the cytosol of the cells, it can be observed by solution NMR. It tumbles freely and gives well-resolved signals in the spectrum. Interestingly, the zinc ligands in the active site contain protons which resonate at frequencies of proton chemical shifts that fall in a region of the spectrum which is free from any other background signal from the cell. So this means that we could skip the N15 labeling of the protein otherwise necessary to get the two-dimensional spectra of the backbone, and just observe the perturbation of this few resonances in the spectrum upon ligand binding. So we applied this bioreactor design to monitor ligand binding as it happened in real time. So this is the overlaid spectra of the, so you can see this is a sort of movie, and we can tell that some signals belonging to the free proteins are going down and disappearing in time, whereas others are appearing. We found a way to semi-automatically analyze this data and obtain quantitative measurements of the two species, the free and bound protein. These are examples of single slices. So this spectra lasted around 10 minutes each. By using a multivariate curve resolution by alternate least squares fitting, so MCR ALS algorithm, we could extract the pure components of the spectrum by giving as input the whole series, time series of experiments. We got as an output the pure spectral components, which correspond perfectly to the spectra of the free and bound protein. This is shown for two different ligands. And that's the interesting part, I think. It's the concentration profile over time, which is basically reflecting the overall kinetic of binding inside the bioreactor. That can be fitted with proper kinetic models, if provided that some assumption can be made about the kinetics of the event. So for example, the fitting in this case is very high quality fitting with a diffusion limited binding model in which the rate determining step is given by the diffusion through the plasma membrane. This can also be applied on two-dimensional spectra, so we can run a series of 2D spectrum that requires N15 labeling, but in turn it provides a lot more ability to separate the different species, because you have 2 dimensions to decrease the overlap of signals. And it can be also coupled with amino acid type selective labeling to separate even more than 2 species at the same time. And we are now collaborating with Bruke, with Matteo Connetstri again, who applied as a user to actually test the bioreactor that we had developed based on the Bruker flow unit, in which we are using this method to actually perform competition binding experiments that allow obtaining information on the affinity constants of these ligands directly in living cells. And with this, I just thank all the people involved in Florence in the development of this bioreactor, and thank you.